There are a lot of things that have been done in the past that we have tried to work through with an enormous amount of positivity to face the future. In Victoria, if we think that in fact the five countries where there are problems with women are overseas, it is not the case. In Victoria itself, we know that women who have disability and illness actually is a big problem for women aged 15 to 54 years of age. One in five women in Victoria experiences some violence, and that's quite a startling statistic, and it's not something that we should just turn a blind eye to. I will come to how this is important in terms of yoga and what the role of yoga in finding inner peace and support can provide for women and for the community as large. Antenatal domestic violence. Now, one would like to think that during pregnancy, which is a very, very special time, that there is a sort of an improvement, if you like, or a better care given to the woman. Unfortunately, at pregnancy, this is when we're actually seeing domestic violence even increase, which is very, very sad. The impact of this on the developing baby is actually quite profound. The changes in cortisol, which is a hormone that is released during stressful activity, during stressful threats or whatever the stress is, can cross the placenta and actually impact on the developing brain of the baby before it's even born. So this is a big issue for us because it means that in the future, if a woman is experiencing big stressors during pregnancy, and that can be physical violence, emotional violence, or stresses of other sorts, that in fact the next generation, even before they're born, can have significant detrimental brain development in terms of emotionality and intellectual development. So, you know, this makes the problem really important that we get on top of. And particularly, it's interesting that in a number of ancient texts, the issues of playing music, calming music, or eating healthy foods and having relaxation for the pregnant woman is actually described. It's something that I think we have forgotten about in terms of where we are now in our current daily lives. Certainly pregnancy is an important time to have some mental peace, and any of the violent situations really do need to be improved during the pregnancy because of the mother's mental health, but also the developing fetus. There is a study that's been done in the UK looking at 14,451 pregnancies, 8,600 involved violence against women, and what have they found? They found that in fact there is profound impact on the child's behaviour for up to 4 years. It hasn't finished the study, that's why 4 years is currently where the data is. So again, we can clearly say that the problems of pregnancy extend into the early childhood behaviours for the child. I want to remind everybody that when you see all the debates about physical abuse or violence against women, it's not only physical violence. It's not just physical injury. It is direct or indirect threats. It is sexual assault. It is emotional and psychological torment. It is economic control. It is property damage. Social isolation. This is when somebody says, you know, you will not visit your relatives, you will not visit your friends. And this sort of control leads to fear. It's behavior which causes a person to live in fear. And that fear is obviously translated into a number of issues that involve biological, psychological, and social consequences. So this is what we have learned. We have learned that the stress caused by outside factors, such as the abuse that I talked about, can lead to hormone changes. Those hormone changes keep revolving around in the brain, cortisol, and that can lead to other hormone difficulties, such as the difficulties with reproduction, difficulties with keeping thoughts in an organized way, difficulties with controlling anger, difficulties in a number of different domains. And this is about an ongoing situation where somebody is continuing. It actually impairs memory in a number of different ways. It can actually affect the structures of the brain. The hippocampus, which is the memory area of the brain, is one that's very clearly affected. And in actual fact, with stress, there is a change in memory and a change in the capacity of the person to be able to learn. This is why children who have a very stressful household find it difficult to learn at school, because they're actually having a biological effect on the brain itself. If we look at the biology of trauma, this is a particular PET scan. You can see on your left that there is a healthy brain, and when these people were asked to do a task in the scanner, they were actually able to concentrate. If you look at somebody who has post-traumatic stress disorder, you will see that there is not a focused group of cells or part of the brain that is lit up. So there is a diffuse problem in terms of getting the concentration in order to do the task. So you can see there's quite a difference in the brain biology between a healthy person who is not stressed and somebody who is stressed because of various factors. We see many effects of abuse or trauma, depression, anxiety, brief reactive psychosis, and this condition, which is a bit difficult to define, and it's termed borderline personality disorder, but is better known or better understood as complex trauma disorder. Complex trauma disorder affects many women. We estimate that about 30% of the population are experiencing this in some way, shape, or form. This is the Victorian population of women. Deep feelings of insecurity, coping with fear of abandonment or loss, rage and anger towards others, even if there is nothing particularly that is happening, a fragile sense of self and one's place in the world, dissociation, that's the sense of being cut off from the actual real life, self-harm. So self-harm can manifest in many ways. The obvious ones that we see in the emergency departments and hospitals is when somebody has deliberately cut themselves or burnt themselves. But self-harm can be in the form of eating too much or starving oneself, abusing alcohol, abusing drugs, and repeatedly putting oneself in dangerous relationships or attempting suicide. So there's quite a lot of self-harm that is seen in the community. Persistent impulsiveness, confused, contradictory feelings, depression, mania, psychosis symptoms. And we're also seeing that many women have this condition worsening at menopause. So they might have been okay during, or somehow got themselves together during the 20s and 30s, but by mid-40s, again, this is resurfacing. This is a disorder that is commonly misunderstood. There is often an anger and rejection of the person who has complex trauma disorder. They are often called manipulative or attention-seeking. They often put themselves into a push-pull dynamic in the relationship. By this I mean they will say to their partner, you know, you don't understand, you know, go away, you're making me feel bad. But at the same time, they're really actually wanting that partner to provide them with the feelings of love and caring, but they make it difficult by not actually being straightforward in an interaction. And this is very difficult for the partner to understand what is going on here. So there's often the situations where there are fights and battles, and she may drive off or she may run off and say, I never want to see you again, you don't understand what I'm going through, all in the hope that he will actually come after her or give her the good stuff that she wants. Knowledge in this research in this area is very poor, and the treatments are sometimes very fad-driven. We think that there is quite a relationship between this condition, complex trauma disorder, and early childhood abuse, stress, and that the two are very interlinked, and they can lead to rage, anger, relationship, and obviously difficulties in both the marital or home relationships, as well as in work and work relationships. We know that with emotional deprivation or emotional abuse, there are same sorts of symptoms, but perhaps to a lesser degree than in those people who as children have had physical abuse. The gender of the patient is important, the gender of the person is important. And violence is obviously something that really makes mental health much worse, no matter whether you're male or female, and the violence is committed against you. But certainly women are much more commonly the recipients of violence. And this is something that really needs attention in a global way, but also nation by nation. There are different problems that different nations need to deal with in order to stop the violence against women. We need to increase self-esteem of women by decreasing sexism. Some cultures are unfortunately more sexist than others. They worship the male of the species, and the female of the species is not seen as important. That leads to poor self-esteem in women, and again, a number of mental ill health conditions actually flow from that. So there is a lot to be done in terms of improving the respect between men and women and women and men. We need to stop precocious sexualization. This is a particular issue in the US and also in Australia, where children as young as 12 to 14 are portrayed in manners that are very adult and very sexual. You'll see the ads where the models and so on are actually only children, but in fact they're precociously made into sexual objects. And this again leads to problems with mental health. We need to improve parenting in general. And this is one of the issues that parents from migrant parents, so coming from India and settling in Australia, raises different issues with parenting, because the background of the parents who have been raised themselves in India is different to what, in fact, their children are going to face in a Western culture, such as Australian culture. And there are real difficulties that we see in second generation Indians. Now, the attachment to parent is really important. In that first 5 to 6 years or even longer, the attachment between the child and the parent is very crucial. And if there are problems there, if there is a loss of a parent from death or illness, or if the parent is depressed, or if there are other issues, then that can lead to ripple factors in terms of mental illness for the child in an ongoing way. And again, a loss or an absent parent can be that parent who is spending hours and hours at work and not perhaps having as much time to spend with the child. And that can be interpreted as rejection by the child, and there can be a number of issues that happen as a result. We need to continue the biological research, which is somewhat lacking, and we need to get rid of the stigma. There is a stigma attached to mental illness, and this is quite difficult for many people to then raise their hand and say, I'm having a problem, and also to get the appropriate help. Yoga as a complementary treatment has been known to help depression, and there are some studies that have been done that look at the particular impact of yoga on depression. 27, this is an example of a study by Shapiro, 27 women and 10 men were enrolled in the study, 17 completed the intervention, and pre- and post-intervention data was assessed. The intervention was 20 classes of yoga led by senior Iyengar teachers, and all the participants who were diagnosed with unipolar major depression, there were significant reductions in the depression symptoms, anger and anxiety, and also their physical health as measured by heart rate. So yoga does appear to be a promising intervention for depression. It is cost effective and easy to implement. There are many emotional, psychological and biological benefits as well in that study, the Shapiro study, as many other studies that have been shown by performing yoga on a regular basis. So in conclusion, unfortunately, we do have this issue of violence against women. There is also violence against men, but women are the more large proportion of people who receive or at the receiving end of violence. It is a problem in Australia, and it is a problem in other parts of the world. And as long as it continues, it does create mental ill health of a long-lasting nature in women. So we need new global approaches to promote harmony and equality between the genders. In some ways, yoga, meditation, and other practices like this appear to be effective in the prevention and also the management of long-lasting mental health. Thank you very much for your attention.